Delegates from the Philippines win for the first time at the World University's Debating Championship. Ateneo students David Africa and Toby Leong had the last word at the grand finals of the international competition in Madrid. The duo bested teams from renowned educational institutions, including Princeton University. The topic of the debate, whether individuals should subscribe to the philosophical concept of the Ubuntu. The humanist belief places emphasis on the community as crucial to the formation of a person as well as of society. The World University's Debating Championship is considered the world's biggest debating tournament. The latest on President Marcos's state visit to China, where Chinese President Xi Jinping vows to find a compromise to allow Filipinos to fish in disputed areas in the West Philippine Sea. Marcos says Xi made that remark during their meeting Wednesday. Our correspondent Katrina Domingo is in Beijing, and she joins us now for details. Kat, what can you tell us?
Hi, Mike. Good morning from Beijing. Several highlights coming from that meeting between President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. and Chinese President Xi Jinping. One of those you already mentioned, President Marcos mentioned, raised the plight of Filipino fishermen who were not able to fish in their traditional fishing grounds due to the harassment of several Chinese vessels. He raised that before Chinese President Xi Jinping. And as you mentioned earlier, the response was quite affirmative, with the Chinese leader vowing to find a compromise so that Filipino fishermen can go back to their traditional fishing grounds, which have been occupied by Chinese vessels for several years already. Aside from that, Mike, President Ferdinand Marcos also announced that the Philippines is ready to continue negotiations on possible joint oil and gas exploration projects in the South China Sea. Marcos underscores that both the Philippines and China will benefit if this deal pushes through, given that the entire world is actually looking for more sources of energy nowadays. Aside from that, Mike, the Philippines and China have also agreed to narrow the trade deficit between the two countries that is pegged at $15 billion. Marcos says that one of the ways and how this deficit can be reduced is through the creation of a Durian Protocol. This is a phytosanitary standards, a set of standards, so that the so that China can import more durian and other agricultural products from the Philippines. You see, Mike, the DFA has described China as the Philippines' largest trading partner, with bilateral trade between the two countries accounting for 20% of the Philippines' total foreign trade. The Philippines is looking to increase its imports or its exports to China so that more Filipino businesses can profit from Asia's largest economy. Now, Mike, later on in the day, President Marcos is expected to meet several businessmen here in Beijing before he flies back to Manila. Priority sectors he will be meeting here are businessmen from the nickel industry and battery producing industry. That's because China imports 70% of its nickel requirement from the Philippines, and the Philippines wants to take advantage of this huge market here in Asia. Mike.
Kat, I'm curious about the messaging coming from Malacanang. They're saying that she is promising to find a compromise to allow our fishermen to fish in the very waters which are rightfully our own. Are we now ceding sovereign rights over this particular area by conceding that it's actually the Chinese president who will determine if our fishermen can fish there?
You know, Mike, it's a very tricky situation when it comes to those diplomatic relationships, as well as to those sovereign rights in disputed waters in the country. The wordings in the press releases released by the palace last night have been very carefully picked, and that they quoted President Xi saying that he will find a compromise. No word there on who will determine which or whether or not one leader of a state would actually give permission to the constituents of another to actually fish there. That's why the word compromise was used there. A very subtle diplomatic term there that would kind of not offend either sides of the party, because as we all know, both China and the Philippines does not want to offend their counterparts, given that they are banking on goodwill to actually forge closer ties between the two countries. Mike.
Kat, has there been any discussion about China continuing to construct establishments or any form of settlements there in the islands in the South China Sea?
No word on that yet, Mike, but later on in the day, President Marcos is set to have a press conference with the Philippine media who covered him here in Beijing, and we ought to ask that question. We also want to know more about Chinese vessels that actually impinged on Philippine operations in clearing rocket debris in the West Philippine Sea. We will have to find out more details from the president later if he will oblige to answer those questions, but so far, no word yet on Malacanang on those fronts. Mike.
Pat, I'm curious about what you mentioned, durian diplomacy to address the deficit here in the country. How much are we expecting in terms of the imports or exports of durian from Davao to China to be able to offset the deficit?
You know, Mike, we spoke to several Davao businessmen yesterday, and we asked how many metric tons of durian are they expecting China to accommodate once this deal is forged. But they say that the negotiations have just begun and that there are no exact numbers yet on as to how much they can produce and as to how much China would actually require from the Philippines. But these businessmen from Davao actually tell us that China is willing to import a lot of volume from the Philippines, but it's actually the production side of things that usually has the problem. We also spoke to Sergio Luis Ortiz last week about this, and he says that the trade imbalance between the Philippines and China is not actually due to China's hesitance to import more from the Philippines, but is actually stemming from the fact that the Philippines could not produce a lot of volume, the entire volume of China's requirements. Also, another issue in that deficit, Mike, is that the Luis Ortiz told us that the Philippines has been importing too many products that it does not actually need to import. That's why he says that there's he accounts for this. He says this is the reason behind the $15 billion trade deficit between the two countries, Mike.
And lastly, Kat, any word, any figure so far on the total investments that have been pledged for the Philippines because of this trip by President Marcos in China?
None yet so far, Mike. We are also waiting for a word on that, and we are hoping that it will not just be pledges, but it would actually translate into actual investments in the Philippines, because so far, this is the president's seventh international trip, and we have yet to get word from Malacanang on how much in actual investments the president has actually was actually translated into actual investments after those trips since last year, Mike.
And Kat, no COVID concerns? Because we note that in those meetings, no one seems to be masking up.
Mike, here before they attend meetings, 2 hours before each meeting, all participants who will attend those events will have to undergo an RT-PCR test. Should they test positive, of course, they will not be allowed into those events. But once they test negative, that's the only time they will be allowed into those events. So far, no word yet on if any of the Philippine delegation actually tested positive for COVID-19. Last night, we underwent another test, and we are still awaiting results to see if the entire Philippine delegation can fly back with the president to Manila later on today, because if any of us test positive for the disease, then we will have to stay here in Beijing until we yield a negative test result. Mike.
All right, and thank you for that update, Kat Domingo. Keep safe.